Try and imagine what it was like to experience this for the first time. In one short fanfare, John Williams sets up the musical language that will provide the basis for every second of music that follows in Star Wars, and also, unknowingly, every second of music that he will write for the 9-film epic that this standalone feature will become. Yes, there are clear influences from other composers in the scores for these films. You can hear Wagner, Brahms, Strauss, Rachmaninoff, Holst, Stravinsky and Debussy, as well as composers from the golden age of Hollywood like Max Steiner and Erich Korngold. But the point was not to reappropriate the music of others, but instead to provide the musical foundations for Williams' own experimentation and invention. By looking to music of the past, it grounds the scores and allows him to create a sound world that mirrors the vast and mythic nature of the story, but that can also be manipulated, expanded, destroyed and rebuilt to better match the subtleties of the narrative. But how do you even begin to analyse how he achieves this, considering how much music has been written? Instead of trying to bring together every score into one analysis, I'm going to look at one set piece or theme from each of the three trilogies, starting with the prequels. Duel of the Fates, from Episode 1, seems to be one of the only Star Wars themes that has matched the popularity achieved by the Imperial March, and it's not hard to hear why. The opening homophonic chords, sung by an unseen chorus, demand our attention. Although it's clearly in E minor, the harmony is nonetheless unsettled. It starts on a weak first inversion E minor chord, followed by an open fourth on an F sharp and a B, only to land on another inversion of E minor, this time a second inversion. The only chord with the tonic in the bass in the opening phrase is the final C minor. The relationship between E minor and C minor in this piece, then, must be significant. Transposed up a minor third, this becomes G minor and E flat minor, which, as you can probably hear, are the two chords that provide the harmonic basis for the Imperial March. But as soon as the C minor is heard, it disappears, and we return to E minor, this time present in the form of an ostinato, a repeated rhythmical idea which persists throughout the piece. This is then followed by a melody played by alto flute, cor anglais, clarinet, and bassoon. The notes that this melody uses, taken from the E harmonic minor scale, are ostensibly very simple. But Williams does something very interesting with the fifth note in every phrase. Instead of continuing the rising scale that he sets up at the beginning, he drops the fifth note down the octave. This fall and then leap of a seventh adds a keening, lamenting quality to the melody, taking it from something that would be relatively anodyne into something that feels unbalanced and intense. Williams then sets up a series of variations of the three musical ideas we have just heard, building intensity through harmonic and rhythmic alterations, as well as through inventive use of orchestration. He starts by adding more parts to the ostinato, the bassoon and cor anglais, as well as the first and second violins and cellos. The melody also moves to the horns. And to add variation, a counter melody is heard in the trombones and bass clarinet. More intensity and drive comes from a repeating eighth-note tom-tom pattern, leading to a reintroduction of the homophonic choral texture. The brass parts become busier, creating a mesh of metallic sound supported by the bass instruments, which are now playing on every beat of the bar. The orchestral melody is then played by tutti horns and trumpets on top of the choral texture, setting up a sort of call and response between the two ideas. Whenever the choir moves into a new key, every other musical line is simultaneously transposed to match the shift in choral harmony. It feels as though the orchestra and choir form one symbiotic organism, moving ritualistically without communication between tonal centres. After moving into G minor, parts of the ostinato start to appear in the horns, trumpets and trombones. This is an example of hocketing, where a melody is passed between different instruments whilst maintaining the structure of the musical line. The orchestra has seemingly ripped itself apart and needs to be reformed. It does this by returning to E minor and starting again, from nothing. This gives us an opportunity to talk about the text. Duel of the Fates is one of the only examples of sung text in all of Williams' Star Wars scores. The words are taken from a translation by Robert Graves of a Celtic epic poem, The Battle of the Trees. Under the tongue root, a fight most dread, while another rages behind in the head. Williams eventually used fragments of a Sanskrit translation of these lines for Duel of the Fates, lending a mystical, cryptic nature to the words, hidden behind an ancient liturgical language. The music turns this scene into something more than just a duel. It turns it into an existential battle between diametrically opposed forces, which are at risk of becoming unbalanced and unstable. Musical stability is something that Williams often manipulates to heighten tension in a piece. As the music starts to rebuild itself, we get the sudden introduction of triplet figures in the strings and a much more energetic hocketing in the brass and woodwind. It feels like it might collapse again, but before it can, rising scalic passages spread throughout the orchestra, leading to an orchestral version of the choral motif, now in G minor, followed by a reintroduction of the choral texture. Then a sudden paring back and another unprepared transposition to B flat minor. Back to G minor. Then to E flat minor. Directly quoting the harmony from the Imperial March. The orchestra re-enters, obstinately in G minor. But it's fragmented, discordant, and irregular. Even as it returns to the original ostinato and orchestral melody, it fails to return to its original key, trying instead to regain some of the intensity of the previous full orchestral and choral sections. It's trying to rebuild itself again. Williams has given us a masterclass in economy here. With just three musical ideas, he has created a work of depth, power, ritual, force, balance, and of course, imbalance. John Williams' scores for the original trilogy are in themselves enough to earn him a place as one of the greatest film composers in history. With its sprawling interplanetary setting and diverse characters, he had the opportunity to write a huge variety of music, which happened to include one of the most iconic character themes ever written. Princess Leia's theme gives us a perfect example of how Williams uses not only melody, but also harmony and orchestration to try and represent in music the soul of a character. The melody is first played by the French horn in D major, underneath undulating, shimmering string chords. The horn is an instrument commonly associated with heroic themes, thanks in no small part to the work of Richard Wagner. But because it plays here towards the top end of its range, there's an expressive, lyrical quality to the tone. After a short contrapuntal interlude from the woodwinds, the melody returns, this time played by a flute, also in D major. The tune for this theme begins with a reaching major 6th interval, and the harmony sets up an oscillating pattern between the tonic, which is D major in this case, and a half-diminished 7th chord based on the second degree of the scale, the supertonic. After moving back and forth between these two chords, the harmony moves to the flattened second chord in the Phrygian mode, E-flat Phrygian. These three chords, the tonic, the supertonic half-diminished seventh, and the flattened supertonic, combined with the interval of a major sixth, represent for Williams the exotic, love, and romance. And if you know what you're listening out for, you begin to hear these everywhere in his work. Han and Leia's love theme from The Empire Strikes Back begins with a major sixth and has an almost identical chord sequence to Leia's theme. In Return of the Jedi, the beautiful, but not often heard, Luke and Leia theme again alternates between the supertonic half-diminished seventh and the tonic, and then moves to the flattened supertonic. Even in Raiders of the Lost Ark, Marion's theme begins with a major sixth, oscillates between the same chords as the other themes, and similarly employs the flattened second. What makes each of these themes unique, then, is how they're orchestrated, i.e. what textures and colours Williams uses, as well as the way he develops the melody. After the second version of Leia's theme, the flute continues with a cadenza-like passage underneath pulsating Brahmsian horn chords. The notes in these chords move in perfect, stepwise motion, mostly only moving by a tone or semitone at a time, with each chord getting us closer to the E major of the third iteration of the melody. The theme, now played by strings, feels more defiant and assured, and sits on top of a horn counter melody, which brings out, most significantly, the flattened sixth degree of the scale. Interest is also added with an additional counter melody in the flutes and oboes, as well as a richer harmony in the string writing. There's more disagreement now between the melody and the underlying harmony, with the bass part often separated from the melody by dissonant intervals, like minor ninths. This creates a need for resolution, and when it finally comes, the result is ecstatic. The music moves on, propelled by syncopated trombone chords as well as woodwind flourishes. It now loses control, and the strings abandon the melody for much more passionate soloistic lines. They move from the flattened supertonic F major to a G flat major bass tonality, to C major with a sharpened fourth, then into five bars of harmony based around the supertonic half diminished seventh, leading us eventually to the dominant B major. And by moving back and forth between C major 7 and B major, with the solo lines taking their notes from the half-diminished seventh chord that has defined so much of the harmony of this piece, we slowly return to the tonic, to E major. Duel of the Fates and Princess Leia's theme demonstrate Williams' ability to create self-contained and stylistically consistent pieces of music, but a significant proportion of his work for the Star Wars series required him to create extended cues to accompany very complex cinematic sequences, and in many respects, this is where he really comes into his own. Perhaps the best-known example of this is his nearly 15-minute score for the Battle of Hoth sequence in The Empire Strikes Back. But I would argue that the music for the Battle of Crait in The Last Jedi gets very close to matching the Hoth sequence in its scale, ambition, and execution. This action cue contains no fewer than 8 themes, connected by driving incidental music, where every bar of music has been carefully linked to the narrative arc.
We have allies.
It begins with the Force theme, in C-sharp minor, as Finn rallies the resistance to fight. This ends on an F-sharp major chord, which pivots into B-flat minor for the first iteration of the resistance march. Trombones are accompanied by a busy snare drum part alongside interjections from trumpets. The unsettled incidental music that we hear next, replete with outbursts of minor triads from the trumpets, mirrors the clunky and clearly outdated equipment employed by the Resistance. But eventually, it settles on a triumphant version of Rose's theme. A theme that, interestingly, has exactly the same opening chord sequence as Yoda's theme. Rose's theme ends with a D major chord, leading into the B minor of the next section. Some of the instability of the earlier incidental music returns, but eventually it leads back into B-flat minor for an even more defiant version of the Resistance March. Then a sharp cut into a second version of Rose's theme as the camera focuses in on her. We then get our first metric modulation from simple to compound time, giving us driving 6/8 and 9/8 meters. This allows multiple themes to be played successively within the same basic meter. First, Kylo Ren's theme as he gives his orders. And then a rapid octatonic passage on top of jagged chords in the strings and brass. The music moves between multiple keys and ideas in this section as the Resistance fail to make strides, from F minor to C minor, now to E minor. It never settles on any tonal center and feels like the music is constantly intensifying and rising. Back to B minor. Then to C sharp minor. More trumpet parallel minor triads appear out of the texture, which lead to a reintroduction of the fast octatonic music. Octatonic scales are used throughout this battle sequence. They are 8-note scales formed by playing alternating tones and semitones, or the other way around. And from this scale, you can construct things like bitonal chords and diminished sevenths, useful harmony for ratcheting up the tension. As the Falcon appears, we hear the first rendition of the Rebel fanfare, followed directly by Rey's theme in D minor, still in compound time. We then get a second metric modulation, back into simple time for the Desperation motif in C sharp minor, to mark the First Order's retaliation. This is a musical idea used at times when the Resistance is at its lowest point. It's passed around the orchestra, from the horns to the trumpets, and after a more discordant version of Ray's theme, its rhythm is taken over by woodwind and high strings. This leads to a version of what I think is one of the best musical cues in the franchise. The TIE Fighter Rebel Fanfare cue mixes Prokofiev-like harmony, full of major triads borrowed from unrelated keys, with the syncopated, driving rhythms of Stravinsky. This short section from the Battle of Crait demonstrates a craft that Williams has developed over a lifetime of film composition. He weaves a complex web of themes, shifting with ease between disparate styles, keys, and meters, all whilst maintaining and building the tension. Williams is clearly a master at manipulating his own themes, but there are times when something else is required. The next sequence in the film provides for me one of the most inventive uses of scoring in the sequels, and possibly the whole series. At the Resistance's darkest moment, Luke appears, underscored by music that seems to harken back to the first time we saw Obi-Wan Kenobi in A New Hope. Williams then deftly mixes the Force theme, Luke and Leia's theme, a melody not heard since Return of the Jedi, as well as Han and the Princess. But after this, a new idea appears. A repeating 3-note phrase, F, C, A flat, played by the violas on top of pulsating F minor chords in the woodwind. The phrase is then moved between different parts in the orchestra, building in intensity as Luke faces the First Order. Alex Ross has suggested that this motif is a reference to the almost identical 3-note Agamemnon figure in Strauss's opera Elektra. In the opera, the ghost of Agamemnon haunts his daughter Elektra, and in The Last Jedi, Luke appears on Crait as a force projection. Williams could well be giving us the clearest hint that Luke is not actually physically present in this scene. This is daring and insightful scoring, and shows that Williams doesn't just want to rely on the music and themes that he's already written. He wants to invent. It is difficult to really sum up the influence that John Williams' Star Wars scores have had, not just on the world of film music, but on music and culture in general. He has redefined what is possible for music in cinema to achieve, and at the same time has created melodies and themes that have transcended their original intentions. People with no knowledge of classical music have listened and re-listened to scores that had their roots in orchestral music written by composers like Brahms, Wagner and Stravinsky over 100 years ago. But despite their enormous popularity, the scores remain a source for adventurous, inventive, energetic, diverse and spectacular music. Music that adds dimension and depth to the characters. Music that turns stories about families, love and hardship into immense mythic epics. And music that transports us to a galaxy far, far away. Thank you so much for watching. This has been an enormous effort, but I've loved every minute of it, and I really hope you've enjoyed watching it. If you have, please do share with your friends and subscribe to my channel. I want to make my videos as engaging as possible, but because that takes a significant amount of time and dedication, any support and help you can provide would be really appreciated. See you next time.